I was like, oh shit, like a real R&B singer.
Wow.
So nowadays you don't necessarily have to sing well to be deemed a singer. So yeah. How do you feel about the music that gets a pass? Do you take offense to it, or do you feel like it more so creates a lane for you?
I mean, that's a good question. I really honestly try not to get into it too much. You know, end of the day, music is music, you know? This could be a hit right here. You're tapping on the table.
Right.
So I really don't try to get too caught up in any of that. Sometimes I do, honestly. I think about me caring about what I do and being, you know, having my hand in everything, and production-wise and arrangement and vocally arranging things and writing, and then I turn around and it's this cat saying one word the whole song, and it's a hit. I mean, I get caught up sometimes, but I don't let it get to me, you know?
I just wanted you to kind of elaborate on how has the journey been kind of having to make your own mark in the industry, you know, as far as videos, LPs, things of that nature.
I mean, it's really, how can I put it? It's really interesting.
How you saying?
Oh, yeah.
You know, like, it is though, because there's so many people that when I first started that I would contact and try to get in touch with and, you know, reach out, you know?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I don't really know you. And I'm like, okay, well, I'm gonna do everything myself now. Everything's in-house, pretty much. You know, there's a few producers I work with. Besides that, I do my own production with my band. And now it's funny, those cats that I was reaching out to, asking for tracks and whatnot, wow, hit me up like, yo, I got this track, what's up? So these directors hit me up to do videos. I'm like, well, I already got a team who does all my videos. I hit you up 5 months ago, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like, I like seeing that though, because that shows that I'm moving towards my goal. You know what I'm saying? Like, the more people that reach out that I hit up before, it's funny. You know, even like sometimes when I listen to like Dwelly and Eric Roberson and Raheem Devon, and then now those cats, like, they know me. So I'm like, okay, I'm doing all right.
Definitely doing what you gotta do.
Exactly.
And you know, when I first heard your work, and I think it was Dopamine, when I first really listened to what she was doing.
Yeah.
That was my immediate comparison, was Dwelly, Eric Roberson. So how's it feel to kind of be in a company with those artists who you may have been looking up to, you know?
That's what I was saying. Like, at first people were like, mad because they compare you to Dwelly and Eric Rosen, but I'm like, no, because we all do soul music, meaning we all have the same influence.
Yeah.
So if you're in a genre of music, you usually listen to older cats, or you dig and you have the same influences as the cats that are out now.
Of course.
So Dwelly listen to Marvin Gaye, Dwelly listen to Stevie, I listen to Stevie, Eric listen to Stevie, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's kind of what it is though. That's why there's genres of music, of course, you know?
Right.
So I mean, It's just my take on what I learned, or what I got from listening to Stevie and Marvin, and it's Dwelly's take on it, and it's Eric's take on it, you know? And then we compare, and then we bring that in with our life, and we make our music. So I'm definitely an individual in my genre, you feel me?
Yeah, no doubt. Listen, we about to get into another...
I remember going to a show at SOB's, I think it was Black Apple.
Yeah.
I was in the crowd, and this girl, I overheard this girl next to me, and she was like, I don't care who comes on, I just want to hear Jesse sing Cold Pillow to me. And she emphasized it to me, and I'm like, yeah, let me give her some room. So how does it feel being a budding, like, sex symbol? And how does that affect your personal romantic life?
That's very true. That was a great question. Sometimes it's kind of like, I'm surprised at it, because I don't really look at it like that. Honestly.
I've heard it. I came in front.
But
no pause. I've heard it as well from females who listen to your music.
Yeah, you know, the music inspired the music. You know, it does a lot of other things
right.
That I can get to. But you know, at first, like when it first started happening, you know, where people would walk up to me and go, oh, hey, you know, yeah, God, you know, I'm listening to you right now. So I was like, oh, that's dope, you know?
Yeah.
And then after a while, it still was like, whoa. Like, even when I got out of town, that's when I see it more. Like, when I'm in, like, D.C., Baltimore, Cali, like, people go, oh, Jamie, do that, like, what's up? And they go, yo, we created the album, you know? And I'm like, it's a great feeling, you know?
Yeah.
As far as it interfering with, like, my personal life, like, it's harder, you know? Like, sometimes it's really weird when I get recognized in places that I would never think that I would be recognized. And, you know, and I sometimes forget that I'm on TV. That had like the BTJ.
Yeah.
So people go, yo, I saw your video yesterday. I'm like, oh yeah. No wonder some people know my face and like connect a name with me, you know? Because a lot of times people just hear the voice and they're not familiar. Like, it took people.
So we got the project that you're coming up with next. You're writing the titles down before the actual joint. So usually is the writing process more or less a melody, and then we get into the words or the hooks?
It actually depends. Like with the Beauty Created album, I did a lot of co-writing with my guitar player, Steve Warren. He played guitar for Keisha Cole.
Okay.
And he was my roommate also, so he would come upstairs with his acoustic and be playing something, and I would come up with a melody and just match words to the melody as we were going along. So it was kind of like a freestyle for like as long as I could go, and then I would stop and write that down and write the rest of the song, you know? Yeah. So that's the kind of process I had with that album. And then the titles would come later. I find I could write any kind of way, but I feel like when I write first and then try to put a melody and music to what I've written, it's a little bit more personal. You know, because it's easier to hit a track and come up with some catchy words that go with the track and make it rhyme, but it's harder to put lyrics or words that you feel to a song and make it a song, and make it like a song that's relevant to the world and that everybody can connect with. So that's what I'm trying to do. Kind of like challenging myself at the same time, you know?
Yeah, that's what it is. Listen, let's get into another joint. Jesse Butcher the Third, right here on Crack the Ship of this radio.
Like I'm saying, the R&B's kind of going down right now. I feel like I'm probably gonna be one of those cats that, you know, get back to where it's supposed to be at. As far as the next few years, I see some Grammys. I want a little gold trophy. Like, I'm not even gonna lie.
Yeah, yeah.
I wanna be able to say that I've collaborated with the people that I used to look up to too, as well. That's one of my big dreams, is to be able to work with Pharrell and, you know, the Timberlands, and, you know, be in the studio with those cats and watch how they process. You know, D'Angelo, if possible. I want to be remembered as a passionate dude, you know?
Speaking of D'Angelo, don't disappear on us, man.
Definitely not. I can't say that I want to do that.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? So, I'll be around. Believe that.
No doubt.
I know a lot of artists, like a lot of rising artists, they have day jobs.
Yeah.
So it's like by day, you know, bagging groceries or whatever you do, and by night you're on your hustle. What's a typical day like for you?
Wow, since my team is pretty small, I pretty much do a lot of things myself as far as like finding new venues to perform at, being a part of, or hitting up headliners to open up for, you know. I do a lot of press work myself, sending in press kits to certain publications, trying to get written up, write-ups and whatnot. You know, I chill, like, you know, I sit around and I listen to music all day.
Let me chime in here real quick.
Yeah.
Time management is a difficult situation.
Of course.
So tell me how, because you're basically like yourself and your team, which is, you know, a small unit.
Yeah.
So how do you manage all that one day?
It's kind of crazy because I try not to look at it like that.
Okay.
As like a working musician or as somebody who you get paid a large sum of money, it's one day and then 2 weeks, 3 weeks later, you don't know when you're going to get another check. That's pretty much how you live. So I just have a list of goals set.
Okay.
And I do whatever it takes when I have that spare time, when I don't have a show, when I'm not traveling. I do whatever it takes to get to those goals that I have set, you know? So that's how I look at it. So, you know, may it be, oh, I need distribution in London, and I want to have my album out in London by October. So when I'm not on the road and when I don't have to record for somebody or record for myself or do anything like that, I'm hitting up people in London to find people who distribute independent artists out there. So that's what I'm saying, like stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, oh, I want to be able to play in this festival next year. Who back to contact to get there?
Okay.
And I'll find my way around. Oh, yo, you know, okay. You can email, CC me on it. All right. You know what I'm saying? So it's a lot of maneuvering, a lot of, you know, a lot of hustling going on in between the time. A lot of times people miss out on that. People just go, oh, you famous, you do a lot of shows. No, I have to humble myself enough to call somebody like, yo, I need your help. Or, yo, I need you to do this for me. Or, yo, if you do this for me, I'll do this. There's a lot of that going on, you know, in the background. So that's what that's pretty
much. Now, I was just about to ask you that next. Like, as you're gaining popularity, what keeps you humble?
Yeah, it's that stuff like that.
Yeah. Having to ask, like, yo, copy that.
There's always somebody on a higher level that can help you.
Of course.
No matter how popping you think you are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No matter how much buzz you have for that little time being that you have buzz.
Yeah.
There's always somebody who can continue your buzz or find you, or help you find ways to get to certain demographics that you want to get to. And that's like my biggest thing is, I want my demographic to be like 12 to like 80. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So.
Always something.